offering quality programs in everything we do, including fine arts, career technical, athletics. How do you develop curriculum and opportunities for students that meet their needs equitably, but also while maintaining quality throughout all of the quality of programming?
So are you suggesting a conflict between those in some way?
Just a lot, right? You have a lot of different programs, and you want them all to run successfully.
Okay. So you're talking about curriculum type programs, not necessarily extracurricular.
I think all of it.
Okay. And in terms of conflict between those, right, if you have to pare down, right? And it does, if you have to pare down, it does come time down the priorities and the maintenance of excellence. I think more important than having everything is what you do really, really well. And sometimes that is, there can be conflicts between those two things. Forest Hills is probably a district that's used to Adams, but I think more. Everything. All of it. And that's great. That is wonderful for kids. But if you're not doing it very, very well, you know, that's probably problematic. And it's time to decide what do we want to do really well. So, you know, that's part of strategic planning. That's part of, again, that full type communication. What are the things that really matter? What are the things that really matter to our community and to our constituency? And what are the things that we're going to invest in to be awesome at? And it might lead to offering some kind of guess. I don't think we're. I think that's important.
Please describe your experiences with millage renewals, bond proposals, and sinking funds. Were these experiences successful? Why or why not?
Yeah, so I got a lot of experience with that in different districts, being on planning teams, running campaigns, successful, some not, managing the budgets that come from them, working with architects and construction managers on the development side and on the construction side. So I got a lot of experience with that. We did run two bond issues, and we asked for, we did an update of our facilities plan in Waterloo League. We asked for the largest single dollar value on an issue in the history of the school. We failed by 60 votes, but we're going to go back. We've already done our surveys. We kind of know what's going to be, what will be supported. We'll go back in May of 25 with a very appropriate program. We might as well count as we had multiple bonds, and they, you know, I was part of the planning committee for those, part of the campaign committee. Of the programs that I operate in, the magnet schools that I manage, I have over some construction programs going on in those. So I got a lot of experience in that. I have not run my own personal campaign yet that was successful, but I've only run one. So, and it's in a tough to pass district, and we ask for the biggest dollar amount, but I do believe it'll pass the next time. I feel very confident.
Example of a time in your career when you made a mistake and you received constructive feedback and then were asked to take corrective action. What process and communication plan did you implement and what was the outcome?
You know, I think for me, the feedback I got that was the most, that was hardest, that made the biggest difference for me when I was in Jackson. I was asked to oversee, I wrote a grant for the Michigan Department of Career Development. It was a career pathway grant. We had done an implementation when I was in River Valley. I was asked to write the grant and oversee and manage a project for the district, and release time to do it, to implement a career pathway model at Jackson Northwest High School. And I was young. I was an administrator. I had been a central office administrator for a couple of years. I went back to teaching and coaching. And I was more like a project manager, school improvement. I was a building school improvement team leader. And then the mayor superintendent called me in one day and kind of gave me, you know, telling Jesus about the ambitious, very driven, very passionate about what we were doing, but I had not done what I needed to do, lay the groundwork and build consensus around it. And it really hit my identity, right? Because, you know, I saw myself as, you know, a doer and get done. And no, that's not what's important. What's important is building consensus and developing trust and building, you know, and it was a real seminal moment for me. I had to kind of retool myself and I had to kind of rethink who I was going to be as a leader if I wanted to be successful at it. And it was great. It was great for me. Great. We did complete the implementation. We did get the program. We successfully, you know, successful change in master schedule, implementation of career pathway outcomes for kids. I haven't paid attention to whether it's still sustained or not. That was in the mid-aughts. I left in 2004. But I know they still remember my name there because I'm in the superintendent. We spent a lot of time together up in Traverse City at the superintendent's conference. So something must be still wrong with that. But I had to check myself. And it did help me become a better leader. At the time, it hurt. It was because of my identity.
Great, thank you. Knowing what you know and have been to see of us, how would you evaluate our current climate and culture in Forest Hills? And how does the superintendent help to improve the climate or culture of a district?
What I know about the culture and climate of Forest Hills now?
Yeah.
Well, I can only conjecture because I haven't done any kind of surveying. I haven't, you know, surveyed people and said, hey, tell me about the climate and culture. Other than it is collegial and people feel good about the district. Obviously, there is, you know, there are concerns about the finances, right? There's a potential budget, you know, budget deficit, declining enrollment. My conversation with principals in the district that I've talked to, you know, there's some areas in some high schools where we need to do some culture issues around leadership, maybe principals, that kind of thing. So there's opportunity, but this is still a district that is perceived to be very strong, high achieving, great place to be, you know, that kind of thing. But the first, so when I came into Water Relief, this pop, flow with me here for a second, I brought HumanX. HumanX is the HR wing of Stryker. They used to be, anyways. They're an independent company now. Stryker is the medical supply company. I don't know how to put it. HumanX was the HR wing out of the now independent company. They do culture and climate surveys for organizations all over the world. I had them come in and do a culture survey. The survey was off the charts. This is the greatest place in the entire world you'd ever want to be. Wonderful, beautiful, everybody's happy. It's sunshine and rainbows and unicorns flying over, you know, beautiful stuff. Right? Then they come in and they did the building level analysis to talk to the teachers. And they came back and gave them a report. This is not. And that's where we begin now. Don't have that's the professional culture side of it. If there's a discrepancy between what people say it is and perceive it is, what it actually is when you do the ground level analysis, the first time you bring in change, you're going to have a crisis. So we've had to work and massage that throughout my tenure there. Now, I'm not a believer in that. We align ourselves. That's the professional culture. But when I talk about culture and climate with my teachers, I'm talking about the soil we plant our kids in. What's that like for kids? What is the culture and climate in your school? Is it a place where they feel physically, emotionally, mentally safe? Is it a place where we manage difficulties in a structured and systematic Those are two separate things. And it's very easy for teachers to confuse them. So when we started our strategic planning implementation, one of our pillars is school culture and climate. My teachers thought we were talking about, are they happy as teachers? We're talking about, do our kids have a good learning environment where they can grow? We got to shift that focus. So I don't know this culture and climate around, you know, kids, and I haven't surveyed to get the data around how it is with professionals. So I just basically am picking up what I can along the way. But if the question is, how do you get at that? You're running surveys, full community. And, you know, we would be, need to bring in an outside firm. I'm not just gonna throw out a Google, you know, Google survey and say, hey, what do you think? You know, we gotta bring in some people that know how to parse this and really get to the psychology.